sense of fevered anticipation was palpable as scores of musicians tuned their instruments in the bow-shaped orchestra pit before the stage. Each instrument was a monstrous contraption of pipes, bellows, and crackling electrical generators, which in turn were hooked to towering stacks of mighty amplifiers, created specifically for this performance and designed to replicate the magical music of the Leia Temple. Coloured lights and strategically placed prisms filled La Fenice with blinding rainbows and cast beams of a million different hues to every corner of the theatre. An army of seamstresses had worked tirelessly to create the stage curtain, and the glaring footlights illuminated the vividness of the red velvet and the wondrously embroidered images of decadent legends, cavorting nudes, animals, and scenes of battle. On the vast pediment above the stage, illuminated by a single spotlight, was the late Serena D'Angelis' painting of the Emperor's Children's Primarch. Its terrible aspect, unendurable finish, and the passion of its outlandish colours rendered those who saw it dumb and robbed them of coherent thought. More of Serena's work could be seen on the vaulted ceiling of the theatre, a colossal multicoloured mural of serpents and ancient beasts of legend which sported with naked humans and beasts of all description. The sheer bulk of the Astartes filled much of the enormous theatre, even though they were stripped of their armour and wore only simple training robes. Those remembrancers that found themselves behind one of the giant warriors danced from foot to foot as they sought to obtain a better view of the stage. The captains of the Legion sat in the comfort of the boxes, arranged in two tiers on either side of the stage. The boxes overlooked the proscenium with an unobstructed view, and their facades were of a classical design, with fluted pilasters to either side. The box with the most perfect viewpoint was known as the Phoenician's Nest, its interior painted with frescoes of gold and silver and decorated with yellow satin draperies that overhung lace curtains. Over it all, a valance of gold silk shimmered in the light of hundreds of candles fixed upon a great chandelier above the center of the stage. A movement in the Phoenician's Nest drew the gaze of the gathered audience, and soon every eye was fixed upon the magnificent warrior standing there. Dressed in his finest toga of regal purple, Filgrim raised his hand to the crowd and basked in the adoration displayed by his legion as thunderous applause built and shook the rafters with its volume. His senior commanders accompanied the Primarch, and as he took his seat, the lights began to dim. A brilliant spotlight shone on the stage as the great velvet curtain parted and Bekwa Kinska made her entrance. Julius watched with barely contained excitement as the blue-haired composer crossed the stage and descended into the orchestra pit to take her place on her conductor's podium. Dressed in a scandalously translucent dress of gold and crimson, the gossamer-thin material hung with precious stones that glittered like stars. The cut of her dress plunged from her shoulders to her pelvis, the swell of her breasts and the hairlessness of her flesh clearly visible beneath. "Magnificent!" cried Filgrim, clapping furiously with the audience at Bekwa's appearance, and Julius was amazed to see tears in his eyes. Julius nodded, and though he had no real memory of feminine splendor or any frame of reference against which to compare her, the composer's curves and obvious womanhood stole away his breath. Julius had felt such stirrings of emotion when he gazed upon his Primarch, heard a particularly inspiring piece of music, or went into battle, but to feel his senses aroused by a mortal woman was a new experience for him. Thick silence enveloped the audience as they waited for the magic to happen. The collective breath of nearly 10,000 throats held fast as the moment of anticipation stretched to breaking point. Bekwa selected a Nemo baton and tapped it on the libretto stand, before launching into the opening bars of the Marivigilia's overture. Tremendous noise erupted from the orchestra pit as the first notes blared from the newly conceived musical devices, the sound reaching to every corner of La Fenice with its wonderful instrumentation, romantic beauty, and hints of themes yet to come. Julius felt himself carried on a journey of the senses as the music rose and fell, emotions he had never experienced plucked from the depths of his soul and brought joyously to the fore as the crashing beats and wild, skirling tunes wound their way through the audience. He wanted to laugh, and then to cry, and then he felt a terrible anger build before it bled away and a great melancholy settled upon him. Within moments, the music had torn that loose, and a soaring elation asserted itself with the utmost lucidity and force, as though all that had gone before was merely the prelude to some grand design yet to be unveiled. Bekwakinska thrashed like a lunatic atop her conductor's podium, jabbing and slashing the air with her baton, her hair a wild comet of blue as it whipped around her head. Julius tore his eyes from the magnificent sight of her and looked out over the audience to witness its reaction to this sublime, raucous music. He saw faces wrapped in stunned disbelief, eyes wide as the power and majesty of the dissonant sounds penetrated every skull and spoke to every soul of the sensations evoked. But not every member of the audience appeared to appreciate the wonder of what they were privileged to witness, and Julius saw many with their hands clamped over their ears in the throes of agony as the music swelled once more. Julius caught sight of the slender figure of Evander Tobias in the audience, and his anger grew as he watched the ungrateful wretch lead a group of his fellow scriveners through the crowd towards the exit. Scuffles broke out, and the recalcitrant archivist and his fellows were attacked, fists pummeling them to the ground where they were kicked and beaten. Without pause, the audience returned its attention to the stage, and Julius felt a fierce pride swell in his breast as he watched a heavy boot crunch down on Tobias's skull. None remarked upon the sudden bloody violence, as if it had been the most natural reaction. But Julius could see the bloodlust spread throughout the audience like a virus or the shockwave of a detonation. The music swept onwards, rising and sweeping around La Fenice like a whirlwind, until at last it reached the thunderous crescendo of its climax, whereupon the curtain rose in a flurry of dramatic and spectacular sensations. Julius rose to his feet as the peals of music drove ever onward, the overture continuing in an unbroken melody of sounds, and the sheer visceral emotions that filled him on seeing what lay beyond was like a punch to the guts. The interior of the Lair Temple had been recreated in painstaking detail, its eye-watering colors and dimensions faithfully recreated by the artists and sculptors who had walked within its magnificence. Vivid lights flashed around the theatre, and Julius felt a momentary disorientation as more music blasted from the orchestra, a new piece with darker overtones and an aching sense of imminent tragedy. The waves of sound and harmony flowed outwards from the stage and over the audience, immersing them in the power and sensations he had first felt when he had followed Filgrim into the temple. The effect was immediately obvious, and a shudder of pleasure rippled through the audience as the powerful notes flowed into and through them. Dizzying colors flashed through the air, and as the music built to yet another high, a second spotlight stabbed onto the stage. The slender form of Coraline Aseneca, the prima donna of the Maraviglia, appeared. Julius had never heard Coraline's voice before, and was unprepared for the sheer virtuosity and power of her singing. Her tone was in perfect, discordant harmony with Bekwa's music, reaching heights no human voice could possibly attain. Yet, attain them she did. The energy of her soprano's voice reaching beyond the realms of the five senses, all of which were being stimulated, it seemed, to Julius. He leaned forwards, laughing uncontrollably as an intoxicating rush of emotion seized him, and he clasped his hands to his head at such overstimulation. A chorus joined Coralina Seneca on stage. Julius hardly noticed them, their intermingled voices allowing the soprano's voice to swoop through even more unfeasible notes, which reached into the very hindbrain to pluck at sensory apparatus Julius was not even aware he possessed. Julius forced himself to look away from the stage, enthralled and terrified by what he was seeing and hearing. What manner of being could hear music of such terrible power and retain his sanity? Man was not meant to listen to this. The birthing cry of a beautiful and terrible god as it forced its way into existence. Eidolon and Marius were as ensnared by the spectacle of the Maravigilia as he was, pinned to their seats in rapture. The jaws of both warriors were locked open as though they entertained the idea of joining with Coralina Seneca in song. But there was panic in their eyes as their mouths stretched wide in silent screams, bones cracking as they distended like a snake about to devour its prey. Hideous, soundless shrieks issued from their throats, and Julius forced himself to look at Filgrim for fear that he might strike down his friends in his fugue state. Filgrim gripped the edge of the Phoenician's nest, leaning forward as though forcing passage through a powerful wind. His hair writhed around his head, and his dark eyes burned with a violet fire as he reveled in the cacophony. "What is happening?" cried Julius, his voice swept up and becoming part of the music. Filgrim turned his dark eyes upon him, and Julius cried out as he saw an age of darkness within them, galaxies and stars wheeling in their depths as unknown power flowed through him. "It's beautiful," said Filgrim, his voice barely above a whisper, but sounding deafening to Julius as he propelled himself from his seat and fell to his knees at the edge of the box. "Horus spoke of power, but I never imagined." Julius watched in wonder, realizing he could actually see the soprano's music as it reached out into the audience and slithered amongst them like a living thing. Their shrieks and cries penetrated the fog of music that writhed in his brain, and he saw all manner of horrors enacted throughout the audience as friends turned and fought each other with fists and teeth. Some audience members fell upon one another with carnal lust, and the heaving crowd soon resembled a great wounded beast, convulsing in agonized throes of death and desire. Nor was it simply mortals who were affected. The Astartes, too, were swept up in the surging power generated by the Maravigilia. Blood was spilled as the emotions of the Astartes were overloaded with sensational excess and were vented in the only way men bred as warriors knew how. An orgy of killing spread from the stage, blood running in rivers as the power of the music thundered through La Fenice. Julius heard a great buzzing, creaking sound, like a great sheet of sailcloth being ripped to shreds, and he turned to see the mighty portrait of Filgrim writhing and stretching at the canvas as though its painted subject fought to be free of the constraints of the frame. Fires blazed in its eyes, and a howling shriek that sounded as though it echoed down an impossibly long tunnel filled his skull with a monstrous thirst and the promise of horrific splendors. Lights blazed around the theater, flowing from the orchestra pit like liquid, the greasy electrical fire lifting from the bizarre instruments and achieving physicality as they became liquid serpents of myriad colors. Madness and excess followed the light, and all those it touched gave themselves over to the wildest, darkest delights of their inner psyches. The orchestra played as though their limbs were not their own, their faces twisted in horrified rictus masks, and their hands frenziedly dancing across their instruments with violent life. The music held them in its grip, and was not about to let any weakness on the part of its creators deny its existence. Julius her notes of agony enter Coralina Seneca's voice, and managed to lift his eyes to the stage, where the prima donna danced in a wild, exuberant ballet as the choristers screamed in unnatural counterpoint. Her limbs snapped and twisted in a manner no human limb was designed to, and he could hear the cracking of her bones as it became part of the million melodies filling the theater. He could see that she was dead. Her eyes, lifeless, every bone in her body turned to powder. And yet, the song poured from her still. The madness and frenzy engulfing La Fenice soared to new heights of excess as all flesh was infected with the maelstrom of sights and sounds coming from the stage. Julius watched as Astartes clubbed mortals to death with their fists and drank their blood or ate their flesh, scarring their skin with the broken bones and draping the torn skin of their victims about them like grisly shawls. Vast orgies of mortals shuddered on the blood-slicked parquet as the living and the dead became vessels for the dark energies pouring into the world, every violation imaginable willingly inflicted. At the center of the madness, Bekwa Kinska conducted the chaos with a delirious smile of triumph plastered across her face. Julia saw the knowledge that this was her greatest work in the light of her eyes as she stared in rapt adoration at Filgrim. Then, without warning, a terrifying scream cut through the crescendo of noise, and Julia saw the abused form of Coralina Seneca twist into the air, her limbs spread-eagled, as some unknown power seized the broken meat and gristle of her body and warped it into some new hideous form. Her shattered limbs straightened, becoming lithe and graceful once again, the flesh taking on a pale lilac hue. Where before Coraline had been clad in a shimmering dress of blue silk, the fabric transformed into a harness of gleaming black leather that revealed the supple beauty of the soft flesh formed from the ruin of her corpse. A horrific, wet, sucking noise engulfed the prima donna, and whatever force had previously held her aloft released her. The thing Coralina Seneca had become landed with supple grace in the center of the stage. Julius had never seen anything so simultaneously beautiful and repellent. A naked female creature that evoked both a potent loathing and a perverse sensuality that gnawed at the pit of his stomach. Hair like needle horns swept back from her oval face with its green, saucer-like eyes, fanged mouth and luscious lips. Her body was sculpted perfection, lithe and sensuous, but with only a single breast, and her skin was loathsomely tattooed and pierced. Each of her arms terminated in a long, crab-like claw of glistening red chitin and moist flesh. Despite the lethal claws, the creature was disturbingly seductive, and Julius felt moved in a way he had not been since he had been elevated to the ranks of the Astartes. She moved with languid, cat-like grace, her every movement redolent with sexuality and the promise of dark pleasures and excesses unknown to the minds of mortal men. Julius ached to taste them. The she-creature turned her ancient eyes upon the choristers behind her and threw her head back to emit a siren song of such longing and heartbreaking beauty that Julius wanted to climb from the box to join her. Even before the note of summoning had dissipated, it was taken up by the frenzied orchestra and grew louder and louder. Julius saw the members of the chorus spasm and twist as Coralina Seneca had, the same bone-cracking harmonies transforming five of them into more of the hauntingly alluring creatures. The remaining choristers fell to the stage as dried husks of flesh, drained of their life, as though merely fuel to power the transformation of the cavorting creatures that leapt from the stage in a flurry of slicing claws and bestial shrieks. The six creatures moved with sinewy, supple grace, the caress of their razor-sharp claws opening arteries and severing limbs with every lissom movement. Bekwakinska was the first to die, a monstrous claw impaling her from behind and ripping from her chest in a fountain of blood. Even as she died, she smiled in delight at the wondrous things she had done. The rest of the orchestra was torn to pieces as the beautiful monsters ripped through them with a speed and sensual malice that Julius could barely imagine. At last, the music of the Maraviglia fell silent as the musicians were slaughtered in the caress of razor claws, their lives torn from their quivering flesh. Julius cried out in the sudden void, the absence of the music like a physical pain in his bones. Though the music had fallen silent, La Fenice was still a deafening arena. The killing and copulation continued unabated, though the shrieks of agony and ecstasy turned to wails of anguish as the music's demise was mourned in renewed bouts of bloody madness. Julius heard Marius give a howling cry of loss and turned to see his battle brother leap from the Phoenician's nest to the stage. Filgrim watched him go, his body quivering with emotion and pleasure, and Julius pushed himself unsteadily to his feet. He watched as Marius dropped into the bloody ruin of the orchestra pit and lifted one of Bekwakinska's bizarre instruments. Marius hefted the long tubular device and hooked it into the crook of his arm like a bolt gun, running his hands along the length of the shaft until it produced a monstrous vibration like the roar of a chainsword. Even as Julius watched Marius's futile attempts to recreate the music, more of the Emperor's children rushed to join him, each picking up one of the orchestral instruments and attempting to conjure the magic of the music once again. Julius felt the breath heave in his lungs and gripped the edge of the balcony for fear that his legs would not support him. What? Was all he could manage as Filgrim moved to stand next to him. Wondrous, was it not? Asked Filgrim, his skin glowing with renewed vigor and his eyes alight with fresh purpose. Mistress Kinska was a fiery comet. Everyone stopped to look at her, and now she is gone. We will never see anything like her again, and none of us will be able to forget her. Julius tried to reply, but a vast explosion of noise erupted from behind him, and he turned to see a portion of the stage wreathed in smoke and collapsing rubble. Marius stood in the center of the orchestra pit, electrical fire dancing across his flesh as he strummed his hands across the screaming instrument. A howling pyrotechnic blast of sonic energy shot from it and ripped one of the balconies from the wall in a devastating explosion. Chunks of marble and plaster flew through the air, and the sound of the instrument drew howls of pleasure from Marius's fellow Astartes. Within moments, each had mastered his device, and a renewed crescendo of howling, shrieking blasts of energy began ripping the theater apart. The monstrously beguiling she-monsters gathered around Marius, adding their own unnatural shrieks of pleasure to the delirious music he was making. Marius turned his instrument into the crowd and unleashed a thrumming bass note that built to an explosive climax. Clashing chords like howls of ecstasy tore through a dozen mortals with an ear-splitting concussion, and each of Marius's victims thrashed helplessly as their bones snapped and heads exploded beneath the barrage of noise. "My Emperor's children," said Filgrim. "What sweet music they make!" Explosions of flesh and stone bloomed throughout La Fenice as Marius and the rest of the Astartes filled it with the music of the apocalypse.